Bird is just trying to convince you to be a gold digger. That's it.
Who's gonna be? Who's
I believe the term is gigolo.
what's the gold digger context? What are we talking about? I lost track.
And who should
I
be
lost
a
track.
gold digger?
Oh.
Yeah.
Literal
I mean, everyone's
gold
talking
digger.
about how pretty he is in the
Oh,
comments.
literal gold digger.
Yeah.
Yeah,
I mean,
there's gold in the river.
Yeah,
I live in the right state.
you'll just have moonshine. Problem solved.
Yeah, that's how it works.
Meh.
Comes
All
with
them
territory.
commenters think he's real pretty.
What?
People think I'm pretty? That's weird. I don't know how
Remember
I
when
feel
you,
about
the
that.
moment you like showed your face after doing a few voice acting videos and stuff?
Oh yeah, people did comment. It was like, wow, you look really good. I'm like,
And then
okay, I guess.
one person did the
Whatever.
awkward split between like, you got a good face and a good voice, but I like your voice better. It's like, why did you have to say that? Why'd you have to
You
say
gotta
that?
choose.
I just like listening to it, not looking at it.
That's
It's like, oh,
like
okay.
doing like I love that's like the one that got that one person was something like saying like I like sad games, but Andrew's the funny one. I'm like, why would you do that? Why is that comment necessary? That just seems like a rude thing to bring up.
Yeah, it's like why would you point? It's like you're going to like an award ceremony. You're like, yeah, this studio won an award for doing something, but that guy in particular is the one who won that award. It's like, damn, whoa.
I mean, Metal Gear Solid 5 was good, but really it was all Kojima.
Know, that's the thing, you know, like if you, it's like, yeah, congratulations to Kojima Productions, but mostly only Kojima, and it's like, I mean, other people work here, man.
All right,
Like
podcast officially started then. We're already on a roll here. Because
I have
all
been
right.
recording.
Yeah,
I have
absolutely.
not.
Well,
I have not, so
they're gonna
there we go.
suddenly pop in all of a sudden then, because surprise start of a podcast.
Well, everyone just needs to remember what we were just saying.
Yeah,
It's
it's fine.
recording.
Don't worry about it.
Yeah.
Are you already
No.
are you recording now?
I
No.
am. No? What? Come on.
I'm trying
Unfortunately,
to, but Audacity just crashed.
I'm already predicting that Mr. Kojima's audio and face cam will be lost for this recording, so we can't
Mr.
include him
Kojima?
properly.
I don't think.
Yeah, Hideo Kojima was actually here for this entire podcast, but we just tragically lost all of his audio and video, so we couldn't prove it afterwards.
It's crazy. We
Yeah,
got
it
that's what I
it
thought was
was
going to
really
happen.
impressive how you got him to come here in the first place. I mean, props to you. Too bad he will never ever return to this event.
Yeah, I'm sorry.
Andrew,
I
that's
just
what I
thought
thought
it.
was going to happen the whole time we were recording Jackbox with the developers. I thought we were just going to
You
lose all evidence that it ever happened before it hit YouTube.
Oh man.
Yeah.
So I got a game today from a developer.
Go on.
Developer is a fan of mine.
Oh.
Go on.
And they want to play with me as part of it.
Oh, it's
Go on.
adorable.
And it's adorable, and I'm just like, I'm not prepared for this, and my schedule is the shittiest. How
I
do?
know it's cynical, but from the comments, can you tell if they're genuinely a fan of yours, or if they're one of those people
Yeah.
like, yo, I love your channel, I totally want to do a let's play of my
They
game with
started
you.
talking to me about my Vigante playthroughs.
Okay, good.
Yeah.
Because I got comments like that before for a game, but they were clearly just trying to be a part of the Let's
They're
Play that
trying
represents
to.
their game so they can be a part
Well,
of the advertising.
so I asked them for a copy, and then they're like, oh, whoa, you're the Vigante guy. And I'm like, yeah.
That's pretty
That's
good.
what you're known for?
Yeah. While you guys were waiting for me to realize that you were all waiting for me,
Yes.
I was playing the new Homeworld game. Any of you guys
Yeah.
play RTSs that much or no?
Nope.
Nope.
Okay, so the very first mission is. So before you start the game, it's like you should play the tutorial to understand how to play. All right, cool. I get that out of the way off camera. I start the first mission. It goes into the like half tutorial, half like deadpan, like you need to do this mission because the world is doomed, and if you don't do it, then we're all dead. But like with that level of delivery, I'm just sitting there for 10 minutes being like, all right, so you're telling me to go attack something. Awesome. You're telling me to go collect resources. Great. You're telling me to how to repair things. Amazing. I've not been talked down to from like a gameplay perspective like that in so long.
It's when you
I don't
get
even
into the
think like the
territory of
original
press the A
StarCraft
button to
was like
jump.
that.
Yeah. Like I mean, we've been playing Dragon's Dogma.
Oh yeah.
That initial segment is awesome. You know, shit's breaking, goblins are everywhere. You fight a chimera at the end, and it's like, by the way, like you don't need to do these things, but you should probably like climb onto the chimera and cut that snake head off, so it stops you poisoning
you and
stuff. You
can play however you want, but it kind of has almost like a Star Wars text crawl of all the commands in the game, and the things you can potentially do.
Like, I actually really like that, because by the third time through it, I'm like, I'm a master of this. But, like, the first time through, I actually felt like I was being challenged here.
Oh, right, because you've played the prologue, like, three times now, because you keep starting over.
Well, the first time was because all my footage was 15 FPS. The second time was because, I guess this is the second time. I've been through it twice.
Huh.
This would be the third playthrough? No. Yeah, this would be the third time. I've just started over twice.
Yeah, I noticed that I dismissed the Koof companion, and when I went to resummon them, they were suddenly, like, half the level, and I think female, with pigtails.
No, no, that is definitely male.
It was definitely not the same Koof as before.
No, it changed. It is green, it has pigtails, and a giant mustache.
Yeah, I had to get rid of the first version of my horrible pawn clone you've created because he had a horrible chipmunk voice that was just the worst thing to listen to.
So I picked it, and it was just like a high-up voice, and I was like, okay, this is fine. Like, slightly annoying, just to annoy Keith a little bit. And then it just went into full-on, like, just bad artificial chipmunk, and I'm just
it
like...
It was the worst... severe sound ever.
I know. I turned off voices for a while because I didn't want to hear him.
No, I didn't either. I took him on one mission to go find the witch, basically, and then immediately disbanded him. So he lasts about 25 minutes of a 30-minute episode.
Well, this one, apart from looking horrendous, should serve you fine.
Oh, Jesus.
That's what I hear. That's what I like to hear from all the brothel girls.
Madame, bring me your most serviceable girl.
I mean, but the problem is, I specifically created this one to annoy Keith and named it after Keith. So it's like creating a shitty clone of Keith and being like, have fun. And he's just like, I don't want to.
Like, you helped. It's like you took a picture of me and then inverted the colors in Urban View and then melted it under a candle. and that's what this is compared to me.
Ladies and gentlemen, this is what an art degree will allow you to do.
Oh, Jesus Christ.
Oh, God.
I mean, you've seen my Dark Souls faces.
Capitalism. Oh, yes. So, I guess this is the podcast is officially started at this point. I don't know.
I'll figure it out in editing, you know?
Okay.
I'll figure it out in editing.
Good luck, Keith.
I'll piece it together. We can't keep starting over.
So I kind of missed the boat on what even Dragon's Dogma is.
Okay, so I'll categorize this stuff because it's basically a Western-style RPG. It got a lot of comparisons to Dark Souls early on because it has a few systematic comparisons, and also because Dark Souls was brand new when it came out, practically. But
they're also kind of rare, you know, like solid action RPGs. Most of them are kind of like the flighty button mashy kind.
Yeah.
And this and Dark Souls are much more methodical in their gameplay.
I'm just finding that upon further reflection, the combat style kind of is more reminiscent of Dragon Age 2 than anything. With a more hack-and-slash
I feel like it's a lot closer to Dragon Age 2 and Inquisition.
Yeah.
But
noteworthy thing is you're not clicking the right stick to lock onto an enemy.
I wish you could lock on, though.
I wish you could.
I got fucked by, I think, the Hydra, because I was, like, trying to back away with the shield up, and my character just, like, turns his ass straight forward, and suddenly I receive giant snake to the ass, and it was bad.
So here's my
it
kind of prediction here.
That's the worst place you want a giant snake.
I think Dark Souls changed the future of Western-style action RPGs in that I that game happened, like, the click something to lock onto your opponent in an RPG... It technically existed before, but I think after Dark Souls, it's going to become so standard to the point of, like Halo's two-joystick first-person shooter controls.
Mm-hmm.
Like, I think ever since Dark Souls came out, you kind of just have to make your RPG have a lock-on mechanic as part of the combat.
That's not a bad thing, though.
No, it's great.
You know what's interesting about Halo, about the two-joystick command or control thing, is that actually GoldenEye allowed you to do that.
It did, but it was C buttons. You could see button strafe, and I did it all the time, and no one knew you could.
It wasn't like that. There was actually a control scheme where you held one controller in each hand.
Yeah.
Oh,
I didn't know that one.
You mean like D-pad and joystick?
No, you use the two sticks.
There aren't two sticks in GoldenEye.
You have two controllers.
What?
Yeah, you hold one controller on your left, so you have a player two controller in your right hand, and it controls one player. Yeah.
like a Wii, basically.
Yeah.
Exactly.
I had no idea. Wow, yeah. When I played GoldenEye, I would use the left hand on the joystick and trigger, and my right hand would be on the C buttons because you could strafe with them. Huh. And so I was basically playing it like a Halo back then, but except my right hand was four buttons instead of a joystick. But it totally worked.
I only played GoldenEye like twice, and I was playing with my neighbor who knew every map, like the back of his hand, would get the golden gun and would shoot me before I could get anything. And I'm like, okay.
So yeah, GoldenEye now. It was fun, but it was not balanced.
It would have been great if, like, we all had the exact same skill level, so we'd all, like, more or less just bum rush the golden gun and kill each other on the way.
Mm-hmm.
But no, I didn't even know how to move yet.
The cool thing about GoldenEye is just that its controls are so weird that...
They were really weird.
In a strange way...
The shoulder button to do the crosshair thing.
Like, in a strange way, GoldenEye in Perfect Dark... Instead of being dated, although some people will just view them that way and be like, this is bullshit, this isn't like shooters.
Yeah.
They're almost so different in their controls that it's a different type of game, basically.
Well, yeah.
Like playing Perfect Dark co-op in the hardest difficulty, trying to go through the campaign and do
that.
The objectives.
It was awful.
It's fascinating, like the way the game controls.
How?
Like, your gun is not locked to your camera in a shooter.
Mm-hmm.
How many console FPSs actually existed by that point?
Hardly any.
They just
really?
Did at that point. There were a ton. It's just people didn't like them that much.
Yeah. Not a lot of memorable good ones.
I guess not a ton in comparison to any time after that, but they definitely existed. They were just weird because no one agreed on good ways to make them. So everyone was just really good at making platformers. So that was most of video games. There was 2D platformers, and then 3D games came out. So then it was like, now the platformers are in 3D, and you collect 100 things in every level.
Yeah. Did you guys ever see the Gaming in the Clinton Eras series?
No. I saw one or two of the episodes of that.
One of his videos, he talks about GoldenEye, mm-hmm. and like one of the offhand, he makes this really great offhand comment of saying like nobody cares about multiplayer because that's not really important, but we couldn't test it anyways because we only had one controller. And I was like, I feel like you're more salty about the fact that it was included in the game versus, like, it's not very important. Like, but he, like, basically, like, berated GoldenEye for being a really shitty game for a lot of, like, really really weird reasons.
They didn't know what to make good back then. Like,
he was like, upset that it followed the movie.
Oh.
Like, he was like, well, why would I play a game based on a movie? I just watched the movie. And I'm like, oh my god, do you not understand what video games are for? And he's like, I really don't like the fact that you can't just, when you're looking down, you have to look down and pick up a weapon. You can't just walk over and pick it up. I'm like, that's not how bodies work. You don't just walk over weapons and they just magically appear
exactly
in your hands,
how
asshole.
Games work now.
Yeah. This is true.
In every shooter, except for maybe like Fallout and games where you are supposed to stare at the floor all the time, like Bioshock and Fallout, like aside from those games, you do just walk over stuff and get them.
It's super awkward to do it otherwise. And like from a multiplayer perspective, imagine if you had to look down to see the gun.
With a controller.
Yeah.
Specifically a GoldenEye controller where
with your C-sticks.
Yeah.
Like,
because with a game like Perfect Dark or GoldenEye, you had to point your gun at the bottom of the screen and to make your screen start scrolling like you're playing an RTS with a mouse.
Isn't that how FPSs with the Wiimote work too?
Yes.
Yeah, like, in the center of the screen, you have like your aiming zone. And
I
then
tried
towards
that.
The outer edges, that's how you like look around and stuff.
Oh, yeah.
Oh. Wasn't there like a...
Yeah, the Metroid games and stuff for the Wii
Metroid.
That had multiplayer,
exactly.
They were basically the continuation of the control scheme from Perfect Dark, which was baffling and crazy and amazing in some ways.
It kind of works in Metroid. I tried a different game called, I want to say it was like Fuse or something.
Uh-huh.
It was like this really bad first-person shooter, and they were like hyping it up to be like the next Halo, but for the Wii. And I tried it, and, like, Shell and I were doing, like, a 1v1 deathmatch just to try it out before we, like, played the campaign mode. We couldn't turn properly, so we just, like, bumped into each other, slowly started turning towards each other, ended up, like, rotating past each other, and then I fell off the map and turned off the Wii.
Sounds about right.
Sounds about
right,
yeah.
It was not fun. And then I watched her play Metroid, and I'm like, holy shit, this is, like, actually good controls. Why did nobody do this?
I don't know. I still can't really use a controller to be nearly as accurate as I can with keyboard and mouse.
Well, you'll never be able to. Yeah. Like, there's some people that can be that good, but, like, there's a reason why they don't connect Call of Duty multiplayer to...
PC across
PC
the Xbox.
PC to console, yeah.
Yeah. I will say, I was playing Halo with some friends in high school, and I had a friend of mine who was an extremely good shot with a sniper rifle, and I started screen-watching him a little bit just to see, like, man, how does he aim that quickly? Fucking aim auto assist, gigantic hitboxes and shit like that. I felt so cheated when I realized how exactly like sniping works on the console games.
Yeah.
What's crazy is that that trend's actually continued further in that direction.
Yeah.
So that now, me and Andrew did that Unfair Tournament series where we would just force people to play random games against each other without any context, basically. We took two people who play Call of Duty games all the time. And had them face off in Halo 2 for the original Xbox, and they couldn't aim at each other. They were literally in the same room with each other in freaking midship, a tiny purple level, and they were running around in the room shooting walls and stuff and not each other, because in Call of Duty, you press the iron sights button to automatically aim at your opponent like you're playing Grand Theft Auto 3.
That's kind
like
of
that's
amazing.
What Call of Duty is compared to like Halo. Like Halo is the hardcore shooter of console games now.
That's weird.
At least in Halo, you have to shoot at people. There's like a little bit of aim correction to help make up for a little bit of precision, but you still have to shoot people with the crosshair by comparison.
Yeah.
So shall we re-rail this podcast and get to some of our viewer questions? Because I have one, and you also had one. From comments, I guess, Keith?
Oh, yeah. Well, actually, I never finished contextualizing Dragon's Dogma.
Yeah, that's true. We did kind of get off topic.
We just said Western RPG with controls and stuff. But,
and now we're on to Halo.
The important thing about Dragon's Dogma is the fact that it has a four-player party that consists of three NPCs. So what you do is you make a main character from scratch, like you do in a lot of Western RPGs where your character's not really a set-in-stone character. And then you, 40 minutes into the game, you make a second character, which is called your pawn, and it's sort of this kind of like emotionless guardian character that follows you around and you also have control over as a full character. But then you go to these stones where you summon pawns from other people's games as your other two party members. And then people will actually recruit your pawn into their game, and there's like benefits for them going on adventures because your pawn can actually learn details about quests they have.
Which is how Wander made the koof.
Yeah. Exactly. Yep. So that mechanic and the grapple mechanic are the two noteworthy things in this game.
The grapple mechanic is so good.
Yeah, you can either pick up, if it's smaller than you or your size. If it's smaller than you can pick it up and throw it, like goblins, you can literally pick up and chuck around, which is hilarious.
Yeah, I've been tossing them off cliffs.
If it's like a human-sized opponent, you can like sneak up behind them and grab them like
Metal Gear Solid style,
so people like kill them off your hands, basically. You can pick up explosive barrels and rocks too, but then if it's something huge like a Chimera or a Hydra, if you grapple them, you can literally start climbing up them Shadow of the Colossus style and try to like hack off individual limbs and stuff.
That sounds awesome.
Yep.
That's really good, but it's a cool mechanic.
Beyond that, even beyond like going up to different like vulnerable parts, so the Cyclops will frequently do like stomp attacks. There's a Cyclops enemy, it's pretty big. If you leap up and grab its leg as it's like lifting its leg, you knock it over and then you can biff it in the face a bunch and then grab the face as it's getting back up and then biff it in the face some more.
Yeah.
Like, it feels so good, and I'm floored that no games do this, because, like, imagine in Dark Souls if you could, like, hop on top of, say, the ancient dragon, so instead of him breathing fire on you, you're trying to, like, scuttle around and avoid whatever.
I just imagine your buddies that are, like, if hacking you climb on top of the ancient dragon, he flies up in the sky and just does, like, a barrel roll.
Oh, yeah. No, I'm sure Dark Souls would just, like, dick you over way more.
Nah, I think that grappling mechanics and like really strong things like that really push games towards what they're trying to achieve. You know, you want to have these really epic feeling moments where it's like a really small hero and this gigantic mythological beast, and you have to like climb on top of them and stab them in their face, basically. And you know, the problem I have with Dark Souls, for example, is that you're fighting this thing that's 50 feet tall and you kill it by stabbing it in the big toe 90 times.
Yeah.
And that slightly breaks the immersion for me. So it sounds like this game, Dragon's Dogma, really nailed managing to make it feel as epic as they were trying to make it feel.
Nope. It's a little bit janky, but okay. Yeah. They definitely do the big monster fights better in terms of, like, immersion.
Mm-hmm. You can definitely still shin-kick Dragon's Dogma bosses to death.
Yeah, it just takes longer.
Okay. Bloodborne actually took a step forward in the right way also in that aspect where a lot of the really good ways to hurt Bloodborne bosses were to trigger a moment of weakness where you could stagger them.
Yeah.
And then when they were vulnerable, a lot of the attacks there would involve, like, an animation where you're just obliterating their head or something.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Which is really cool. I got 2 points here, but I really want procedural damage, so if you hack on the limb enough, it falls off or something.
Yeah.
Like, I think I'd be more okay with that from, like, a Dark Souls perspective. Yeah, it's really hard. Yeah. But
from a programming standpoint, that just sounds like awful.
The boss called the Rotten does that.
It's really hard from programming.
Mm-hmm. Really?
In Dark Souls 2, the boss called the Rotten.
Right.
It's hard because he dies a little too fast, but yeah, you can actually make his arms, they actually fall off each individually.
You can do that with the Lost Giant, or the Last Giant, too.
That's what a lot of bosses do.
You can actually chop his arms off. It's really hard to do. I saw somebody do it in a YouTube video. You can only do it when he does... It's so rare that you actually get a chance to hit his arms, but if you do hit them enough, he actually can't rip his arm off because he loses his other arm.
Yeah. Huh. Yeah, you can definitely take the limbs off the Last Giant and a few other enemies.
But imagine if the boss just had one big health bar and then seven other health bars, so leg. And if you just do enough damage to the leg, it's not that the damage is procedural, you're cutting bits off programmatically, it's just they have a stump pre-existing there and a leg pre-existing there, and they're just kind of stitched together, or the model changes when you cut the bit off. Because I know it works that way in Monster Hunter, but it's only certain parts. And I think it would be really nice if you specifically are aiming at this one dude's leg, and suddenly he's legless Pete. And suddenly the boss becomes trivialized because you were that focused on one specific section.
But then you have to program the behavior to model all those different states you can be in.
Yeah, all the and different animation types.
And that's where it becomes really... Yeah, the animation state machine actually isn't so bad. It's literally just programming the behavior to change.
Because now when the enemy loses an arm or a leg, and which right leg, and all... Yeah,
yeah. So you just have this really weird state machine where it's okay, if I'm missing... And it blows up in complexity really fast, where it's if you're doing this attack... and you have one leg, then this should be the result of it. But if you have two legs, then it should do something more like this.
At that point, you are kind of asking for the level of logic in the character design that you expect that the game actually normally only demands from the protagonist.
Right.
Of how do I really behave with these 17 different weapon sets and stuff.
That's true.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, I'd still like it if more enemies had at least one weak point that you could hack off and deny something.
We'll get to that point in a couple more years. 10 years, that's going to be stuff that's pretty much... built into engines
years,
and it'll be pretty handled.
The other point I was going to make is, we mentioned Shadow of the Colossus, we mentioned Dragon's Dogma, we mentioned Dark Souls having an influence on Western RPGs. Problem is, I don't actually see that being as true as MMOs being the main influence on RPGs, which is pissing me off a little bit.
Why?
Just because MMO combat is really boring, but a lot of people have been making RPGs that are sort of MMOs, were going to be an MMO, and then
Xenoblade Saga, Dragon Age Inquisition. Yep.
Mm-hmm.
Xenoblade's a little bit easier, it was kind of a fun game. I was already used to the combat system and I enjoyed it, but it really did feel like it was built to be an MMO at first, and then they were no, never mind.
Mm-hmm.
And so the story felt like it was made out of cardboard.
There's definitely a lot of games now where they just make a giant map and then fill it with enemies and generic quests that take up more time. So in a weird way, games are becoming more and more like Assassin's Creed. And I don't think anyone really wants that. So it's kind of a bummer when you enter a game
I like the idea of a big open living world, but they don't do that. It's just usually a bunch of hotspots with events and side quests to clutter it up. I mean, Saints Row 4.
And a lot of trails between them.
What game ever feels like it has a living world anymore besides, Witcher 3?
GTA.
GTA.
But does GTA even, though? Because GTA...
Yeah, Like GTA, like people are doing things.
I would say GTA, yeah.
The problem with GTA is that it's convincing on a macro scale.
Yeah.
It's kind of like how you can look at SimCity, SimCity 2012 or whatever.
Yeah.
And if you're not following the individual characters, it looks like it's a real city that's working properly. But if you pay, if you're on a micro scale at all,
too.
It tends to shit itself. And like the problem with GTA is that, like, literally, like standing in a hallway or like on a sidewalk, someone will assault you because they get mad at you because you're near them, even though they walked up to you. Because like everyone's mad at you all the time. Yep. People randomly
deck
you in the face.
Well, welcome to like New York City or San Andreas. Like those.
It's mostly because they have this philosophy of stupid shit equals fun.
Yeah.
And they've kind of always had that.
It's a situation where you can launch GTA 5 and stand still and then get arrested. As a series of events that happen with the world just doing things to your character, basically.
Yeah, I would argue, though, that like Grand Theft Auto isn't really like a living world. Like, how often do you see a person, you know, come out of their house, hop in their car, drive to their job, you know, get out of their job a couple in-game hours later, drive to McDonald's,
But that's the thing. That people do that. Like, you can watch people get into a taxi cab and drive off. And, like, they're going to a destination. And, like,
the second they disappear behind a tree, you never see them again.
Yeah.
Well, yeah, but I mean, there's only so much you can ask.
I would like to be able to stop a dude and see what he does over the course of his day.
Well,
but, like,
you can do that, though. Like, you can follow that guy in the taxi cab, but
very
you just can't let him get away from
or he'll disappear forever.
Yeah, that's the problem. Like, I'd want to run into, like, this soccer mom in her van, like, 2 minutes later, there she is again, still on her way to, you know, the school to drop her kids off.
I will say GTA 5 is a more convincing simulation than Fallout.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Oh, absolutely. Fallout was just... hotspots and
I'm about 70 episodes now into Fallout 4, basically, and I'm just getting mad at all the characters who speak. Just all of them. Because, like, the game keeps making you go into these headquarters for various factions to do anything, basically. And so, like, I'm dealing with a railroad for example. It has one entrance into their base, and there's just people in every direction in this relatively dense room. So you're entering the radius of, like, five characters per moment as you walk through the room. And if you enter anyone's radius in a Fallout game,
they immediately talk to you
as if you were obviously talking to them. And they're rude to you.
That.
Like, God damn it, I'm busy. Can't you go bother someone else? And I'm like, who are you? Like, sometimes I literally don't know who the person is yet, and they're mad at me for bothering them. And I'm like,
just
I didn't
walking
even look
into
you yet.
I have that problem just walking into Diamond City. The NPCs walk by me and they're like, you know, generic NPC dialogue.
Oh, yeah.
And
someone steal your sweet roll.
Well, sometimes three people walk past me at the same time and say the exact same gossip.
Yeah.
But there's not enough of it to keep it interesting. And they say it simultaneously.
I mean,
one point,
it is the wasteland. There's not that much going on.
But you have two people, a man and a woman, slightly desynced from each other, talking about where's Nick gone, more or less. And it sounded really freaking weird because, like, at first it was completely synced up and then it, you know, split off because they're different people and the voice acting was different. And I was just like, I'm not okay with this.
What's rough is none of it's contextual either. So, like, in the railroad, someone was testing a gun. So they test the gun, something goes wrong, something kind of blew up, and he's like, ow, my arm. And he's holding his arm. And then he's like, what? Then they say something like, man, Diamond City's really run down these days. Like, literally a second later, they just turn straight towards me and gossip at me. And I'm like, dude, you just got blown up, kind of. Like, what the f-? But immediately, there's no personality or character to anybody. There's no continuity. Like, people don't even know to just, like, say, maybe shut up for 5 seconds after this thing happens. Like, it's the same thing that happens in the opposite fork there with, like, Wasteland. In Wasteland, if you ever accept a quest from anybody, the exact moment you finish the dialogue, a pop-up box shows up from a little quote box pops up over their head that says something along the lines of, like, man, you haven't gotten that thing yet? And I'm like, what the fuck? Like, a millisecond happened, and the game's already broadcasting that message that they should know better than to give me already. Like, just give it a basic timer, at least, before the first time that message pops up.
It's
rough.
There's a lot of... Yeah, like I... with with Fallout specifically, I ran into the issue of, like, I fixed the wasteland by building enough cities that are stable on their own.
Mm-hmm.
And then, like, every time I show up in the city, people are like, oh, there's this problem. We don't have enough of this. And I'm like, yeah, but I built this entire Minuteman network of other cities that you can communicate with to get fucking supplies from. Like, why don't you people communicate? Why do I have to be the damn postman?
You know, I really want to play that. Fallout 5, your character doesn't matter. The game will solve itself. Whether or not you're there, so, like, say if it's Fallout 4 all over again, you have the settlement, say your character's not there, what's-his-face still sets up the settlement, starts
Preston
building it up without
you. Preston just does it.
Yeah. Preston just does it.
Fallout 5, Preston does it.
But, like, imagine it if, like, the characters weren't just, like, prop things, but they actually had, like, behavior, so if you just spend all of Fallout resting in bed over and over and over again, eventually Preston takes over the entire, you know, Commonwealth as, well, like,
I would,
this, like,
I,
just because, Legion
I would
General thing.
Set weight to 100 years.
I would almost say it would be better to, like, I want to play Fallout 5 where I just play as dog meat.
That'd be kind of fun.
Because no one talks, like, to you.
Yeah, because no one talks to you. You're just a dog. So no one,
like,
bothers you at all.
Like Dog Island, but post-apocalyptic.
Yeah, that's your default. Like, I'm playing, it's like Homeward Bound apocalypse style.
As long as it's
game.
Not Air Bud Fallout Edition.
No, I don't think I'm gonna play
that.
Like one.
Oh my
actually,
god!
No. All these games.
I would totally play Air Bud Fallout Edition if it was something along the lines of, like, Blood Bowl, but good.
I'll only play it if you use the NBA 2016 engine. Like,
yeah.
It's very specific.
But with dogs.
I would love to play, like, a simulator in an Air Bud sim game.
Oh, no.
That sounds awesome.
You have to manage the Air Bud team.
It doesn't even have to be a
you know what? No, that would be a great indie game. Yeah. You're trying to accurately portray what would happen if a dog was on an NBA team. And so, like, the dog's trying to dribble it. It's just awful. And, like, you're just trying to not get in people's way and hope your teammates can win without you for the most part. And, like, it's only one mission long because there's no way you can win a, like, serious basketball game where one man is a dog.
It sounds like a perfect indie jam game.
Yeah.
I feel like it'd be great to... I would like it to be a game where it's you have to, like, get a dog scouted by the NBA. Like, you have to make a dog play so well that he gets,
like,
scouted by
the
NBA.
The only choosable character is a dog.
Oh, my God. It's called Air Bud Underground or something.
You're not even playing the games. You're just, like, managing it somehow and, like, background RPG statistics and, like...
What, exactly. A management game where you manage a team of dogs trying to play basketball? Coach mode from, like, a Madden game, but with dogs.
I would almost
just
be willing...
Like, various things. Like, one of the players is an anthropomorphic washing machine.
He just, like, rolls the ball around and shoots it out into the goal.
Exactly.
So the top search result I got was the strange story of the pro basketball player who broke his leg and made a video game that's GTA with dogs.
What?
Wait,
that's what I got for trying to look up a basketball dog video game.
Oh, I thought you just went on
giant,
like,
a world of cel-shaded dogs. It looks like an iOS game.
Oh. Yeah, that's better than what I do. I just go on Google News and I click, like, top news articles, and it's always just the worst stuff.
We live in a strange world. I was the world's first professional Iranian basketball player to ever play in the USA. And then he broke his shit in 2011.
Wow.
And made this dog game. All right.
Well, with that... Let's segue into your questions. We have to do that at some point.
Oh, yeah, right. So in our first ever podcast, we got a question regarding D&D, basically. And it's kind of a question that I expect to get because we talked about D&D, and it's like the basis of a lot of the RPGs a lot of us have played, but a lot of people have never played it before and don't actually know where all this starts, kind of. So... Basically, the comment says, I'm genuinely curious about what D&D entails. I've heard good things about it, but never specifics. I have no idea what the Dungeon Master does, what the parameters of their work is. I have no idea what there are for stats customization. even though I've played all these RPG points games before.
And and he's heard a big question.
He says, I heard there's like a map, some books for reference, and some dice for RNG, but that's about it.
I mean,
all right. Well, every D&D game, there's only one campaign and there's only one map. And you pick one of three classes. You can either be a bowler, an umbrella smith, or a lollipop salesman. And the idea is you need to go around and find all the treasure that was left behind by your great uncle, Schmedley.
All right, Bird, yeah. When I'm DMing, you are a lollipop salesman. I'm going to remake your character. You're going to be a commoner lollipop salesman. Everybody else gets to be barbarians and shit. You're the lollipop salesman. Good luck.
Lollipop salesman.
Good luck. And you can only buy lollipops. You can only buy lollipops because why the fuck would a lollipop salesman have armor?
No. Could I be an arms dealer, but I only sell actual arms?
Yeah. How are you going to get a good supply of arms?
Cannibals. Yes. Because then I can just slap enemies with arms.
Well, okay, anyway, for a serious non-bird catcher answer. okay.
That happened.
I just saw something else. Okay, so D&D is a loose set of rules that most people tend to ignore, but like it depends on the edition you're looking at. Let's take 5th edition, because it's probably the best for most people by now. There's the Player's Handbook, DM's Guide, Monster Manual. Those are the three books that you pretty much need to play. Luckily, there's like a system reference document online, so you can actually get by without any of them if you're really, really like...
You gotta know what to look
stingy.
For.
Yeah, it's hard without them, but it's useful. But usually, you have one person being the Dungeon Master. Uh-huh. They are the game. The players just kind of interact in the Dungeon Master's universe. So imagine if you're sitting at your computer, you have like a vague idea of what you want to do, and your computer's actually a person, and he's telling you what you can and can't do.
Yeah. In the in-game explanation and, you know, the way that the
monsters,
game is designed...
combat, yeah,
well,
everything.
Is that the DM is God. Like, yeah. Alpha, Omega, God.
Yep.
At the end of the day, Dungeons & Dragons is like, it's like half a game, but more importantly, it's like half a collaborative storytelling experience.
Yeah. That's exactly what it's
like. You're all getting together, not just for the interest of winning, but because you all want something cool to happen, basically. But and in order to make that cool thing feel worthwhile and like it matters and why anyone even cares about it afterwards, as opposed to just making shit up on the fly or whatever... you have that really complicated set of rules because that creates a world that's concrete, and when there's rules, then there are constraints, and there's things that can be expected to happen, and then that creates a situation where when something unexpected or really lucky, for example, happens, there's context for it that gives it weight. So like it creates these life and death scenarios or complicated problems for you to solve, so that there's stakes and reasons to work together and all the ingredients you need to basically lead to like a story happening and like something that you would actually talk to people about afterwards and say like that time that thing happened and you have like these actual memories as a result because it was something cool.
Yep.
As opposed to punching a guy for 500 damage and he falls over and then you win.
Yeah, that's boring. just reminded me of one of my favorite items ever got in a campaign. Could hold an infinite number of things, but it could only be corpses and like whatever they were wearing and whatnot.
That's glorious.
That's horrifying.
It was horrifying, I know, but like every time we killed something, I would just cram it in the bag. Mm-hmm. And at one point, we murdered a whole town, and I crammed the whole town's worth of people into the bag. And I slowly switched the character over to be evil and a necromancer.
I would just
upend the bag on enemies, drowning them in like rotting organic matter because there's diseases and smell and whatever. So at one point we were fighting something really hard and I'm like, no, you know what, I'm just upending the bag, and then I animated it and they just died because they couldn't move because it was just a sludge of not good.
That's the grossest fucking D&D story I've ever heard.
There's a reason why I don't play necromancers. So, but it was awesome.
What makes D&D really special is that almost everything that's memorable and interesting out of it is entirely an emergent thing. There's not, like, any point where you're ever forced to, like, play a game, per se. Oh, like, it just kind of happens.
There are. I've had DMs that have been, like, so rigid to the rules that nothing interesting happened.
And those,
so
and those are DMs that don't understand what D&D is.
Yeah.
Basically. Right. Yeah. But the point is that it's supposed to be structured enough that you have the freedom to do whatever.
Like a good example of D&D and how it can be better, for example, than video games was actually Wander and I were playing Divinity Original Sin last night, and there was a guy who needed to escape a jail cell, but he lived in there so long that he's grown since he went through the door originally because he's an orc and he can't get out. I teleported him out, and he disappeared, and the game broke.
Well, he wanders around for a while, being like, I can't wait until I'm free and can see sunlight.
Yeah, he was still talking like he was still stuck inside
his cell. Like, he walks by a bunch of imprisoned people, and he's like, you know,
I wish I could freedom get out will of this come cell someday.
And then Keith like, turns around to figure out what I'm doing, turns back around, and the guy's gone. So we, like, walk outside. It's like, is he here? No.
Like, he was literally
just disappeared from the universe.
Walking in Wander's direction, and I walked down that hallway and just hit Wander without hitting him. And I'm like, where'd he go? He just bled out of existence.
I think one of the things that really makes D&D work in ways that video games can't work is that D&D feels like it has a lot more permanent consequences. You know, with a video game, if the main character dies, that's the end of the game. You just try the level over again. But with a D&D campaign, if somebody dies, you incorporate that into the story and you move on. And that makes stuff
I get real angry
really
when my characters die, though. Because
yeah,
it's usually because of bullshit reasons more than anything else.
It's usually if a character dies, it's because the DM messed up.
So first time I ever played 3rd edition D&D, we were pretty close to the rules. I have a barbarian. Dwarf barbarian, massive amount of HP, like really tough dude. Gets critted by a battle axe, all of his health gone, one go, dead.
Yeah.
I was just sitting there, just like, eyes blank. This is like me, third grade. Just like, the world
is
hell.
Well, they sent someone too strong for your character to handle.
It was a goblin! Like, it was a goblin! With a battle axe! Using two hands! It was so bad!
I got 10 sessions into one character, they just suddenly died of mummy rot. And I was just like, alright, I guess that's over.
Take a bath or something.
Guess I'm making a new one.
I had that happen to my character, except for, isn't there like a rule that you turn into a mummy if you die of mummy rot?
I think
it
was contextualized differently for me, because I think people have even said, people have told me since then, I think that mummy rot's actually supposed to take a while, but I was like dissolving to dust
in
the moment, basically. So like I think the mummy rot
unless your constitution was
wrong.
3 to begin with.
No, because I was like a melee character.
Yeah, that would not happen because I think mummy rot's
I mean, if you have
take
a constitution of 3, can't you like not move or anything like that?
No, constitutional even if you get a constitution of 1, you're fine. Constitution of 0, you just flat out die.
Yeah.
Yep.
But I thought that there were some consequences when your constitution got that low, like you weren't able to move or something. But okay,
no, you just
not.
You just suck.
You just have like a no moral backbone.
Like actually, well, I think I have a story that sort of
wisdom.
Shows what was interesting about D&D and to some extent.
I was making a very stupid joke.
Did
okay,
I tell
continue.
The scorpion thief story last time? Because we told the we had a few discussions about D&D last in the first episode. I think I don't think I told this one though.
I mean, I wasn't there for the first episode.
Right, so. Two of you weren't there.
Yeah.
I guess Wander, tell me if you've heard this one already, because we were...
Before we start, I'd just like to mention, mummy rot is 1d6 constitution damage every minute.
Oh,
that's pretty fast.
That's pretty fast, but that's not that.
You
fast.
Can work with it, yeah.
Yeah, I don't think
anyway.
We had anything we could do about it. Unfortunately,
no one could heal you.
I don't think you can heal it. I think you have to get rid of it.
Yeah, you can't. You can't heal it normally.
We're talking about characters that probably had like 24 hit points total.
Oh,
so it's kind of a big chunk of health there.
Yeah,
it's a really big disease to have that early on.
Yeah,
that's what I'm saying. You got sent against stuff that was way too strong for your characters to handle.
Like D&D is interesting because it's so systematic and so rule driven and has so many mechanics to it that it can give weight to basic interactions that otherwise, if you were just like telling a story, you could be like, nah, I got a super shield and whatever, like two people, like kids pretending to shoot each other in the field or whatever. Mm-hmm.
That's kind of what D&D is like, though, except like you just have to follow the rules of the DM.
Yeah, well, except like all your special tricks are on a sheet of paper and predetermined. So like even if people don't know about them, the DM knows about them because you were like making your character or whatever.
Right,
that's actually
a
fun thing to do, is keep secrets from other players about how your character works sometimes. But
like Paul Rick.
there was a cool scenario where we were all in a jungle temple for some important quest reason for the main story, and I just kind of left and took a different path because I was a selfish character and kind of a racist and just wanted to profit off of things. So I just went on my own thinking I could find something cool and no one would know that I found it. And I found this giant vault-looking room after several empty rooms. And I, at this point, imagine like a giant Mayan temple, and I'm basically on the opposite side of the entire floor plan, where no one would ever know where I am, basically. And I find this ajar door that's huge, but I can't open it for some reason. Like, it's just slightly open, and it won't move any more than that, and I can't really see in the room. So I kind of stumble over the pile of crap in the middle, and I'm just stealthing this whole time so nothing would hopefully see me. Like doing sneak checks and all that, and when I enter there, I'm inside the room, I get a good glimpse of what's there. Untold amounts of treasure, and also the biggest fucking scorpion that you could ever invent for like a fucking Mega Shark versus Mastodon movie or whatever the fuck. Like a scorpion that's so impossibly huge that it couldn't even leave the room at that point. And at that point, I'm like, well, crap, I'm in this room, that thing's there, I'm pretty much not interested in any of the money anymore. So I'm doing sneak checks to try to leave the room again and just get the fuck out of there. I literally get just outside the door and I fail a sneak check like at the last second, where presumably like I've knocked something over or stepped on a twig step or fool of a took, why don't you throw yourself in next time to save us the trouble type moment. And so the scorpion notices me. And one of its big-ass claws sticks through that gate and grapples me. And there's mechanics to deal with grapple checks and everything. So, like, this is all mechanically
driven. Grappling is so much fun.
So we're doing all these crazy dice rolls of, like, how much damage I'm taking each turn, basically, as it's basically crushing me. And it literally goes down to the moment where I have, like, -1 hit points, which means I'm unconscious but not dead, because you die at, like, -10. And it has a critical fail where it actually loses its grip on me, and I slump onto the floor where it can't reach me. And so my character is now this unconscious character lying just outside of this chamber of this massive scorpion that can't leave. And I'm completely isolated on my own, completely separated from the entire party. And it's just this entire scenario that's insane that you could only establish with this crazy rule set that like makes everything so systematic and interesting like that. And then eventually someone found me on the ground, but like that's the kind of cool shit that like...
Yeah.
There's so many elements there that are just nuts.
And it really stokes the flames of your imagination, to use the stupidest phrase I could come up with.
You get more more nervous about dice rolls in that game than anything else because of how much it's not even just a matter of like the dice rolls being random leading to cool things, but like usually it's not that many dice rolls determining
one bad
the end
roll
result
can,
of
like,
something.
Mess up the cool thing that you've been trying to do for ages.
Absolutely.
Yep.
Like, as opposed to Final Fantasy, where you hit a boss 500 times to finally take it down, a lot of things in D&D are, like, 3 rolls, basically.
Yeah.
Like, they can be over so much faster.
It really depends on the character.
Depends.
Like, my character's, my current character in the campaign we're doing is a wrestler. And so, like, his entire point is to just grapple somebody into submission and not let them ever act. But of course, every once in a while I get like the natural one, and then Bird gets murdered by a horse.
That did happen.
And, yep.
That did happen.
It sucked, because like, you know, my job's failed, and the rest of the party is not optimized for combat.
And then you guys switched to Dark Souls 2 and got murdered by more.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I mean,
that's why I became the horse catcher.
I'm glad you were slowly accepting this fact.
It's a spin-off channel origin story.
Nay. Alright, so we got another question.
Damn it, Wanda,
if you want it. If you could live as one character from any game ever made, which character would you live as?
Huh.
Yeah.
One character in any game.
Pretty cute question.
I'm trying to think of a game that where the world isn't at stake.
I was gonna say,
or if it is at stake, you're not really that.
I don't know.
In that
I,
much
I guess that would be Cooking Mama.
Why?
Because her life sounds like it kicks ass. Wow. She just cook all day.
That sounds like a work. I don't want
to
do work.
Just wants to be a domestic housewife. It's okay.
Jesus Christ, yeah.
No, I'm just saying, you have the least chance of getting your ass handed to you if you're playing Cooking Mama. if you're Cooking Mama. Well, I mean, I'm going to be Lara Croft or Nick Drake. I don't know. I'm going to be Gordon Freeman. I'm going to get shot 7,000 times. That sounds great and die. Yeah, sign me up for that shit.
Gordon Freeman would be kind of butts.
Yeah, it would.
Just communication problems when you get married.
Get married? How would you even do that? You can't propose.
Alex would propose, and then it would kind of all, the cutscenes would kind of take care of itself, as it usually does.
You can never acknowledge that you want to get married.
Yeah, they would just hand you a button to say, press this button to say yes, and then you would.
Well, you could just wave your crowbar vaguely in their direction, and they'd take that as a sign. Okay.
Oh wait, there's Doctor Who video games.
Hit Alex in the face
games.
With the crowbar to propose,
but softly. Unlike everybody else, you just biff her softly, and she's invincible, so it doesn't matter.
Like what character? I don't know. I'd probably just be like Bigby Wolf from Wolf Among Us.
I don't
know. He gets real fucked up though.
Yeah.
Well, yeah, but at least I get to like kill people. Up. I don't know. I get good things at the end of the day though. You know,
from what
I get
I've
to
read
smoke...
so far of the comics, he doesn't have a great future coming out for, for a while.
That's not true. He gets to smoke cigarettes, kill people. That's good enough for me. That's all
I need. He has a lot of bad
things
in his
future. There are better characters for that sort of business.
Yeah, he can be the Hotline Miami dude. He smokes a cigarette.
That's lame.
You could be Snake. Snake smokes a lot.
That's true.
Hell no.
But
Snake
you have to shove
way
the cigarettes up your ass first.
I'm trying to think what's some game that has like a happy ending and everything's pretty cool for a while after that game and it ends with like someone getting born, because that's the person you should be. It's like just be that person in the new perfect world after all the bullshit happened.
Shadow of the Colossus. You could be the dude that gets born at the end of Shadow of the Colossus.
Except for like you're probably
you
a demon
live
baby
in that
and
world?
Everyone hates you.
Or I guess, why don't you just be
the kid...
You get
to live in a garden for the rest of your life. Fucking sign me up.
Just be the kid at the end of Mass Effect 3 that's getting the story told to him.
Oh, Jesus. The distant future of question mark.
Whatever. There's no problems no more.
There's literally no certain factors there except for that somehow Buzz Aldrin's still alive, apparently.
What?
The ending monologue is of Mass Effect 3 is a story being told to you by Buzz Aldrin. Like, he actually is the voice actor of the character.
Oh, the voice actor. I was like,
I was really confused.
That detail?
Yeah.
There's no good answers to this unless you pick, like, a casual Wii game where everything's perfect all the time.
Yeah, I want to be Mario.
Because I mean, that wouldn't be too bad. He doesn't seem to ever actually get hurt for realsies. Like, he gets, pretend hurt.
I want to be Ash Ketchum because I get to capture all the Pokemon and be a Pokemon master.
And everything attacks you?
Yeah, and you live in a world with no adults?
Yeah, but who cares? You get to beat all of them up with monsters.
People on the street assault me.
I wouldn't mind being like Lloyd from Tales of Symphonia. Things went pretty well for him in the end. It's real good.
I would be a Prinny.
Wow.
God. Oh, you're dead.
I mean, it ends quickly. I suppose.
And relatively painlessly, probably.
Wow.
A Marine from StarCraft, if we're going for people with a lot of longevity.
Oh, yeah. No, why don't you just be like the SCV guy?
Oh, yeah.
I'm just sitting here wishing that there was...
SCV, good to go, sir.
Oh, Jesus. I'd be Pequod. Jesus Christ. Yeah, I don't... Quad. There's not great people to be in video games.
No. Video games
it
don't generally
to be
have,
everybody.
Like... Yeah.
You can either be boring or dead. There's really nothing in the middle.
I mean, such a huge percentage of video game characters have their deaths cemented in stone, basically.
Yeah.
That's tough.
I mean, you could be the princess from Braid.
Oh, yeah.
You gotta stalk her for a little while, but, I mean, then you get married to a Donkey Kong-looking knight dude, and it works out.
Someone's suggesting I could be the Ark... Someone on the Ark in Soma. Without spoiling anything, because that's really tough to get into, but... You don't want to be anyone in Soma, no matter the context.
Why would you want to be anybody in Soma?
There, even the people in the Ark, even like without even saying what any of that means, there's no good in Soma because you still know things that are awful at that point.
I want to be the guy who's not has no association with any of that crap, but still living in the world of Soma.
Yeah, that's like, not great.
Andrew, you could be Earl Harbinger, leader of the Monster Hunter International and chain smoker. No. Badass in a bulletproof minotaur hide.
Dude, that guy works like so hard, though. I don't want to deal with that crap.
Just be the main character of a dating sim like Hoonie Pop.
Oh, no. That's less effort.
Wait, but if he does that, he does that, then he will transcend YouTube because apparently that's what he's good at now.
That's true. He would get sucked into the TV screen.
I would probably promptly kill myself if like I ever was in like cartoon. That is an anime series called like Date Alive, where like a guy has to deal with monster girl, like not monster girls, but like these crazy powerful girls, and like the way he deals with them is like somebody over an intercom gives him three choices to pick from, just like a dating sim. And I was like, that would be the end of my life. I would just be like, I'm out. Nope, I'm not gonna deal with this.
It's like, hit on the crazy chick. You're like, no, I don't want to do that.
Yeah,
hit on her.
That's not a good idea, guys.
Tell her boobies are wonderful.
I'm sitting here looking up Assassin's Creed characters to see if they had good lives.
What? No, they're all historical figures who ended up dying.
Like, Da Vinci dies when he's 67. I'm pretty sure people were mad at him or something.
I mean, people were really mad at Da Vinci and, like, everybody. Everybody in history was mad at everybody.
That's true. Right now, the present is always the best time to be alive, no matter when the present actually is.
I think you honestly chose pretty well when you said cooking mama.
I think, everyone's shat all over Bird's head.
You don't get to go home, though. That's your life.
Ever.
Like, every day of your waking moment is cooking.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah, that's crap.
I guess there's that part.
Like, I don't want to do that. You don't even get to eat your own food. You just get to make it. You just have to make food for this invisible deity and a camera.
Can I be Zach in Dead or Alive Extreme?
Isn't that the dude that just owns the island?
Yeah, he just owns Volleyball Island.
He just owns
everything.
Doesn't like the second game end with him like getting exploded or something?
He survived it.
We don't need to know that.
He survived it? Oh.
Yeah.
You can't kill Zach. He's in every Dead or Alive game.
Yeah.
Okay.
They'll run out of black people.
the only one.
Wow.
He's the one black character.
So
they can't kill
true.
Him.
Yeah.
Unless, I don't know if La Mariposa is black or Mexican. You can't really tell because they all have generic anime faces except for Zach's very black guy face. So you can't really tell. Because Zach looks exactly like, who is that guy? It was the black guy that was in action movies in the 90s where he had like green hair and shit. Like he looks exactly like
Morgan Freeman.
Or Chris Tucker? Talk about Chris Tucker?
No.
That was the 90s and 2000s.
This is dangerous. Let's just stop it. Let's stop this with black people.
I am lost, but that's
talking about
okay.
Jackie Chan?
Yeah, nailed it. Congratulations.
Yes.
Jackie Chan
was born a poor black
guy.
Child.
Yeah. That was the only black guy in Rush, right?
Yes, he was both of them.
Anywho. So...
I mean, any character that is, like, functionally immortal by the end of the game would be pretty great.
Yeah.
Or has, like, some kind of respawn mechanic that you can just totally abuse.
Super Meat Boy.
The nameless one from Planescape Torment. That worked out well for him.
Jesus.
Any game with Torment in the name, generally not kind of high on my list here.
They're making a sequel to that.
Planescape Torment's a really, really good game.
There's absolutely a good game, but I don't want to live in it.
Yeah. No, I wouldn't want to live in it either. Because the game ends with the main character going to hell. And is literally just beset with an eternal war.
If you could be any video game character, what would you be? Somebody from I Have No Mouth and I Must Scream.
Oh God, no!
Where they keep remaking me until I lose track of what man, what human, human means.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. No thanks.
I've never played that game.
I haven't either.
It's
actually
really old.
Heard enough about the book it's based on to know it's horrifying.
They made the game worse. They made the game more horrifying.
I want to be the kid from, what's it called? Heavy Rain? The kid that didn't die.
So you want to be, kidnapped like, for like a few weeks?
What?
You want to be kidnapped for a few weeks, basically?
No, no, no. Oh, yeah, I guess that's true. Yeah, I want to be kidnapped for a few weeks. But then, like,
you can die in that game.
You can, but, you know, the right ending is the one where you save them, so...
Literally every character... That's the good thing about that game, is at least by the end, like, every single character can die, which is kind of cool.
I want to be the chick from Clock Tower.
No, oh, God. No.
I want to be the scissor guy from Clock Tower.
Yeah, no. I want to be the Clock Tower from Clock Tower. What? Because I don't have to deal with any of your guys' bullshit. I just sit there and go, bang, bang, it's 12 o'clock.
Jesus Christ. Do we want to do anime follow-up before this gets more out of hand?
Yeah, let's go ahead and do that.
Sure, sure.
So how far did you make it through the recommendations, Bird?
I made it through Gangsta. All right. That was the only recommendation I remembered, yeah. So that's what I did.
I genuinely don't remember if the other recommendation was during or after the podcast.
Yeah.
Did you watch anything, Wander?
I tried watching Gangsta. Wasn't that excited about it.
Okay. So,
okay.
So Gangsta... And it's been a little bit while because we recorded our last episode like 3 weeks ago, and I watched it immediately, and I would have been on time if we had watched, if we actually had recorded another podcast next week after that. But
we didn't.
Well, we had Christmas and whatnot.
With Gangsta, I was totally sold by like the animation and the tone and voice acting and so on. Like, I liked that. I especially got a kick out of like the protagonist or sort of main character, just kind of two or three. It's a little hard to
Nicholas to say who specifically is extremely cool.
Like, Nicholas is a mute. Well, like, he's not mute, he's deaf, and just chooses not to speak as often as possible because he can't enunciate things well, and he just kind of sounds dumb when he speaks, so he just usually doesn't.
Yeah. But,
like, he's a really well, like, he and his sort of brother, like, adopted brother, basically, at that point, they're like these nicely developed characters, and then the show introduces a little bit of a threat of like basically everyone like Nicholas is being hunted down by some organization, and that organization is barely even targeting him, but just everyone else more so, and then, you know, by extension, eventually him, basically.
Yeah, all the
and
tags.
And then the show ends forever.
Yep.
Yeah.
And then the company that made it goes out of business.
So that's the only unfortunate part, is that it is just a one and done. Kind of thing.
Mm-hmm. And not even that, but it doesn't even have like a finished arc.
No.
Like, they start a big conflict, and then it's such a cliffhanger ending that it literally involves both of the main characters falling in two different contexts, and then cut to credits, and it's never coming back.
Yeah, it was intended to have two seasons and did not get it.
Yeah. So if you want to finish the story, you have to read the manga as it's going, basically.
Yeah, you can, and the manga is still ongoing. You can read that. And it's...
gone through about 5 plot arcs at this point, you know. Yeah. The stuff that's introduced in the anime is all tied up in the manga, so if you really wanted to go find it, then there you go.
What's frustrating... I found myself comparing Gangsta to Firefly, not like in sheer quality or anything, but just that, like...
But in the cliffhanger
they
sense.
Both have, like, a 13-episode thing where they introduce some characters... And they start giving you some backstory on those characters, and a few characters interact certain ways. Maybe someone dies or gets betrayed or whatever, and then there's kind of a conflict a little bit, and then it just no episodes ever again. It's not even that it gets interrupted. It kind of never starts having a driving force for the story, in a weird way, which is a weird thing to happen.
Yeah.
I've only seen it happen in those two shows, basically, where like Firefly doesn't have a plot, basically.
Yeah.
True.
Gangster,
which is very sad. It sucks.
It
sucks it for both of them.
They're
quite
both
a lot.
Things that are so set to make you care about all these characters and its world and have like a cool premise, and it's all set to start its story, and then it's over.
It is.
I really liked Gangsta, but
I hated its intro.
The character of Alex really, really, really just like never did not get on my nerves. I hated the way she was portrayed the entire time.
Oh, the prostitute character, right?
Yeah. It was
I'm bringing
so
up the
much
wiki
of like
to
this,
tell who people are.
Yeah. It was so much of like she's like a prostitute, and then like she basically like gets saved from like the life of being a prostitute or whatever. And it just strikes me as being like a really, really, really weird representation of like sex workers and prostitutes. And it kind of just portrays her as, like, this broken, damaged woman the whole time. And I thought that was a little bit, like,
I found that she was too much like Jubilee, basically.
Like, yeah.
She gets saved by the main characters at the beginning of the first episode. Mm-hmm. And those characters have a whole established story and organization, a way they do things day to day, and we're getting thrown in with no context, so that character getting explained stuff is the whole reason we know anything that's going on.
Exactly. Like, she's supposed to be the person we identify with.
Yeah, but as a result, just like Jubilee, she's kind of just in every plot point all the time without having much reason to be there.
Yeah.
And so she just kind of stands there and looks surprised by stuff a lot. And so then they don't, in the context of just the anime at least, they don't get a chance to make her really do much besides be this like girl that doesn't wear that many clothes and is kind of having PTSD flashbacks over what happened at the beginning. And
it's like
stands around.
Induced flashbacks or something. It's really kind of strange.
Yeah, they have like a made up drug that makes you think that makes you go insane and kill yourself.
Yeah,
basically.
She's like hallucinating while going through withdrawal of like this
like
weird
super heroin.
Yeah. Yeah. It's a drug that it's supposed to keep you complacent to, like, your pimp. But she becomes kind of more important later on in the manga. Like, there's a lot more going on with her, because as you saw, like, at the end of the series, like, it shows her brother joining up with the, one of the mob families.
Uh-huh.
And so, like, there's stuff that goes on there, but, yeah, for the most part, she was just kind of like, she was just there because she just, you know, needed to set up for a payoff later, and that, you know, because that never happens. It's like, well, why is this dumb bitch here then? Like, she didn't do shit.
And the singing sequence with her at the party was really cringy, too.
It was really forced. It was like, let's just give you something to do.
It was like, oh, she has this beautiful soul that's been, like, hidden and repressed or whatever.
Yeah, it's really generic.
It was really generic and cringy.
I will say that between our viewings of One Punch Man and Gangsta, I've gotten real familiar with the use of the phrase "chota mate,"
because
they use it every 10 minutes in every episode, over and over again.
Yeah. Like, oh, from what anime?
There's certain phrases that are used so frequently that I'm just picking up on them constantly. Yeah,
chota mate. The ones you'll learn, the best ones are like
Gangsta, and it's used like 3 times per episode in One Punch Man.
Yeah, like the best one is like Bakemono.
I don't pay attention to the actual Japanese so much, so
you pick up on it after you watch it for so long.
For me, it's not I'm not picking up on sentences, it's just expressions you hear so often that you start hearing it. Like,
yeah, Jesus Christ. Bakana is one of those.
Yeah,
oh,
if you watch Kaiji,
I love that.
If you watch Kaiji, you hear Bakana like every 5 minutes.
Every 5 minutes, like Bakana.
Just over and over again. And then Zawa.
What about
that's the best. The like ch-ch-ch-ch-ch-ch-ch-ch. Like, what is wrong with this guy? He's got like a demon whispering to him every time he thinks about anything. It's like, I gotta go to the bathroom. Ch-ch-ch-ch-ch-ch-ch-ch-ch.
Are we talking about Kaiji right now?
Yeah, I guess.
I had to look it up because it's a word that the manga artist uses nonstop in the original art, where he just keeps writing the word Zawa over and over again
in
the background, and it's like a tension sound, basically.
Yeah, but
they took it literally when they made it an anime, so you just hear these men, like a chorus of guys in the background going, Zawa, 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 in the background whenever tension happens.
Yeah,
and then the words popping up on the screen and everything's going purple.
It's fantastic. It is fantastic.
I know the word opai now.
Well, yeah, who doesn't know opai?
Yeah.
I mean, especially after One Punch Man, he literally wore a sweatshirt that says opai with two tits on it.
And that picture of boobs on it,
you can buy that sweatshirt, actually.
Oh, you can? That seems nice and perverse.
Oh, it's amazing.
I just realized we never contextualize Gangsta.
What do you mean?
I mean, it's an anime.
Yeah, if you're watching this much still, it's basically X-Men, kind of.
That's a fair characterization.
Yeah, it's got its own made-up world that's kind of in the past, like pre-computer-type setting, where the type of place you'd expect people to be driving around with Tommy guns and shit like that. And
It takes place in like 1920s America mobster world,
but it looks like
with
Venice.
Like fictional districts and stuff like that.
But it takes place in like Italy, and there's like super people that are like drug induced superhumans.
Yeah,
and it's like there's a lot going. Like,
the opening sequence is animated incredibly well.
Its animation is as good as its music is bad.
Yeah, that's
kind of the downside.
It has a fantastic intro that has terrible club dance music with uns going on and some auto-tune, I think. And I'm like, why is this happening to me?
And then the entire soundtrack in the actual anime is... that over and over again.
Yeah, the...
Nicholas! Warwick!
another one that has an awful, like, a new one that started this season is called Dimension W. It has one of, like, the
I
most, like
that one, actually.
The opener, though, is, like, I totally agree that would just be something I'd hear in a club. It just sounds like club music.
Though, like, to be fair, they just have the character blank-faced dancing.
Right?
Like, that one guy...
I was really upset that was, like, 30 seconds into the opener, character's just doing a dance. And I'm like,
I was totally okay with that, because it was
really
completely out of character. So it's just, like, this ninja guy that, like, hates robots, and he's just like, I'm just gonna dance.
Like, that's really out of character for him.
Should we watch that one next, then?
There are only two episodes right now. Oh. Yeah.
It just aired.
Yeah, it just started airing. I like it, but that's just because the main character is interesting. I mean, he's pretty much Ninja Batman, sort of.
I mean, that's a good reason to watch something. Just because I like the characters.
Yeah, I've been reading it, and it's good. The only problem with it, I would say, is that it has this weird, what's the word I'm looking for? It has a really hard to sell plot. Like, it's not, it's kind of like, have you ever seen like Psycho Pass or Ghost in the Shell?
Yeah.
I've seen Ghost in the Shell.
It's kind of like that, where it expects you to be like, look, you're either going to put all of it in or you're not going to like it. It's like, you got to be really into this story or you're just going to hate every aspect of it.
I really like Ghost in the Shell, so anything that even comes close usually feels pretty
good. Ghost in the Shell.
Yeah.
They should. It's probably like the most intelligent anime that exists.
Standalone Complex is phenomenal.
Yeah. I mean, Ghost in the Shell is up there with Akira, and that it's like, if you want to familiarize yourself with anime...
Oh, Akira is like...
Watch this.
Those are like the three unanimously positive things in anime or like that everyone kind of agrees on, right? Or like Ghost in the Shell, Akira, and Fullmetal Alchemist Brotherhood?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, for the most part. Basically any Miyazaki movie, people just go like, that's good anime.
Well, that transcends anime.
The Borrowers one was bad. I didn't like that
one. The Borrowers wasn't that great. I think like, I actually just got done watching Grave of the Fireflies for the first time.
Mm-hmm.
And that one's just brutally sad.
It's brutally sad. Grave of the Fireflies is like, you need to set aside some time to process that one.
Because that's like, the Atom Bomb movie, right?
Yeah,
that's the one that's Japan's perspective of World War II. And you're like, I don't even need this right now. my life is going good. I don't need to be brought down by your sadness.
Mm-hmm. But I mean, I would say that like Miyazaki films, I think that they're beyond like what I would consider anime, just because
when I think of anime, Disney.
I think of stuff that's like mostly
made for
TV
Disney of anime, right?
And serialized. Yeah. I mean he's Walt Disney of anime.
Yep.
I would say that he's come into his own beyond that.
Yeah, but I mean that like growing up, his idol was Walt Disney.
Analog.
Yeah.
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 An analog. That's a good way of putting it.
So, am I the only one that watched Kaiji out of this group, besides the fact that Andrew watched it presumably before recommending
I've
in the first place?
I haven't watched it, no.
So, to explain what the show is, Kaiji is a show about a guy who, basically, he co-signed on a loan and inherits a huge amount of debt, basically, when that person defaults, and gets pulled into a Hunger Games-style thing where, like, rich people pit poor people against each other to try to pay back their debts, where half the people can try to, where the end result is basically going to be that half the people are going to have their debts resolved, while the other half are basically just going to be even worse off and get pulled into like indentured servitude to work off the rest of it.
You have to take on debt to join the Hunger Games. So like on top of the debt you already have, you have to take more debt out.
You have to borrow the money that you're going to gamble in the gambling for the competition. Because instead of Hunger Games where you're fighting to the death, in this one it starts off with what they call restricted rock paper scissors, where everyone gets rock paper and scissors cards. And you go around the room and you can challenge people to matches of rock, paper, scissors where you play a card against your opponent's card blindly. And the moment you play a card, it's gone forever. And so there's a set number of cards of each type in the room. So it's a mixture of, like, gambling and statistics going on and all these mind games and people trying to figure out ways to, like, play everything against each other in the room. And it's, like, the premise is interesting, and I actually, like, I'm into the story and how they tell a lot of the things and, like, how it pays off. Holy fuck, does it have the worst pacing of a show I've seen in an eternity. Because...
is it slow or what?
It gets slower every episode.
Mm.
Like, every episode. To the point, like, and it gets to the point where, like, every additional, like, each challenge or scenario they set up for the show tends to last, say, 5 episodes or more. Like, the first one's probably the longest one, and then the rest are, like, anywhere between 3 and 5 episodes for a while. There are individual episodes where one move happens.
Yeah.
In the entire episode of 20 minutes.
Yeah, the pacing is tough.
That's
and the
bad.
And the episodes like aren't even 20 minutes long in some cases, because they will spend sometimes 3 minutes of the episode having the totally pointless narrator recap the events of the previous episode in excruciating detail sometimes.
That narrator's got such a good voice, though.
He's got a great voice. You could delete him from the entire show and have no effect on the show.
Well, that's
true. Because he literally will repeat stuff that people say, to the point where at one point Kaiji says, "I'm mad," or he thinks that or something, and the fucking narrator says, "He's mad," and I'm like, "God damn it, narrator." And then he says something so else, good. And the narrator repeats him again, and I'm like, "Narrator, you're so pointless, go away."
I love that narrator, he just comes out of nowhere and wastes time.
Yeah, he just says stuff that people already say. He repeats and explains the stakes of everything that you already know again, and like,
I mean,
it's
an anime for kids. You know, kids are dumb.
But it shouldn't be, because it's horrible and graphic and terrible things happen to people.
Yeah.
And it's brutal.
I mean,
and
like Van Helsing shouldn't be for kids, but it is for kids.
It is one of those, it's definitely one of those things where this is only for kids in Japan.
Yeah.
This comes to the United States and it's gonna have a very different rating, because people are getting like limbs taken off or they're dying horribly.
Yeah.
Like,
it's really interesting because the other series that same person did called Akagi is like, it's so much opposite of that, where it does, like, it's all about Mahjong, but if you don't know Mahjong, fuck you. Like, it's not about you then. And they won't explain anything that's going on. Like, he'll do some crazy move and you're like, how did he do that? And you're waiting, and then it goes like, yeah, I win. What did he do? What was his move? I don't get it. And it's like, the announcer's like,
if like Yu-Gi-Oh was like that or something, where Jim Bob
like,
imagine... try to sell the toy.
Basically, imagine if you're watching like a Pokemon battle, and then like no one's explaining that Pokemon are doing moves, you just see Pokemon attacking each other, and then one wins, and you're like, what happened? Like, I don't understand. Did they just beat each other up to the end? And like I knew nothing about Mahjong. By the time I was done with it, I still knew nothing about Mahjong. Somehow Joe and Kel like actually took a book and learned Mahjong while I was like watching this, and like at the end they were explaining moves to me like, oh, I know how he did that. He did that, you know, it's worth 3 points. And I'm like,
are you serious?
I was like, are you guys kidding me? I don't know, that's 3 points. It's just fucking 3 peacocks. Like, what is that supposed to mean to me?
Three goddamn peacocks.
That's basically
there
the opposite of how most anime treats those types of competitions, where they usually abstract it.
Yeah.
But like, there's always still like. But it still has the weird tension pacing, so it's like everybody's like looking at each other like, huh. And someone's just like,
Is like, that okay. The one where the character has the massive freaking nose?
Yes.
Okay.
Yep.
I think I've seen stills from that.
The massive nose that's not from Kaiji?
Same guy.
He's also got
Akagi,
the giant nose. He just likes noses.
The Akagi guy looks the exact same.
Oh, really? Okay.
Yeah, the Akagi guy just has white hair instead of black hair.
So, like, it's weird. Like, I think I would almost recommend Kaiji because I like the story and where it goes, and even especially its ending. Like, I think it actually nails how to end that kind of story in season one and have it actually be, like, character-driven and based on what you know about an existing character and what's going on there. And it's actually manages to be tense because all of the consequences for screwing up are so bad in most cases.
I wish you could
watch it on double speed without fucking up the audio.
Yeah.
Because, man, it's like, so... It takes way too long for every episode to happen.
if you read the manga, it's a lot shorter just because they don't have to deal with the superfluous
bullshit.
Mangas
are almost always a lot shorter than their animes.
Yeah. But it's just really unfortunate.
It's a 25-ish episode series that should have been one of those 13-episode series.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah.
But what's weird, one thing is that I wanted to bring this up when we were doing the intro outro thing earlier. Like, Kaiji has like one of the best intro and outros I've seen in a show before. Because it has this intro music sequence that is straight up like this. It's garage rock and it's all shouty and like punk music sounding, and it even ends with like a series of shouts in the song that are actually voice like mouthed by the character on the screen, and it all works. It all fits together perfectly, and you see how frustrated the protagonist is throughout the entire series. And there's a very somber outro song that looks like it sounds like something you would hear during like a Tarantino film, like it'd be background music for a scene of Kill Bill or something. And it's just and it's these nice little atmospheric videos. And what's baffling about that is that season two rolls around and suddenly you have screamo metal music that goes into super auto-tune territory with a terrible intro. And then the outro of Kaiji Season 2 is some character that looks like it's probably a guy in drag trying to flirt with Kaiji, and they're having quirky scenes or something, and it has nothing to do with anything I've seen in the show so far, and completely contrast the tone. And I'm like, what did you do? Did, like, Season 1 not quite do well enough, so they completely panicked and, like, tried to, capsulize it better with a different and much worse intro and outro?
It's an unfortunate thing where, like, there is only so much music that they can grab for anime.
Oh, God.
So sometimes, sometimes they just go, like, look, we need a new opener for this, you know, anime. This is the kind of music we're looking for. And then if you get, like, one or two responses back of, like, I got this screamo song. I mean, that's all I got. And it's like, we'll just roll with it. Fuck it. Like, that's why you'll notice, like, you'll see a lot of animes that don't even there's certain animes like One Piece or Fairy Tail where they like change their openers like every arc, and like, you know, yeah, you're big, you can have the money to do that, but then when you have smaller animes, you'll notice like music is so drastic between seasons. You're like, what the fuck happened?
Attack on Titan season 1 and season 2.
Oh yeah, very different.
One is that, like, super iconic song that everyone thinks of for Attack on Titan, and the other one was like a German anthem, I think.
Yeah, it was just basically a really boring German anthem.
Yeah, it was.
And it's
like for me,
yeah,
like, I'm used to the J-rock intros that happen all the time, where it's like, it's fine, and it's like catchy
Death
enough,
Note and stuff.
But you kind of get past it. Like the slightly worse versions, all these intros that are basically like slightly worse versions of what Fullmetal Alchemist has, basically. But the original Kaiji intro stood out to me as being up there with like the Ghost in the Shell intros. Of like, these are so different from anything I've seen in an anime intro that I'm like, it's gonna stick with my in my head as like this thing that like was the exception to all the other anime intros. And then but unlike Ghost in the Shell, where they did another song from the same artist, and wow, look at this, Kaiji just says fuck it, and they just go to one of the worst intro songs I've ever heard.
Another one that has a really good intro song that fits it really well, even though it does not look like it at all, is Watamote. If you look up that, I wouldn't recommend watching it, because it's definitely not something you'd get a kick out of, but the opener for it is, like, when you're looking at it and you're looking at the character in regards to, like, the song, you're like, this is such a juxtaposition, but it fits so well with just the animation that's going on, the opener, and the, like, everything works so well that it's like, this is a really good opener, but like everything just feels really weird about it at the same time, because it just doesn't look like an opener that would be playing during this character being here. But
do that happens a lot. Do we want to try to pick a new anime?
So somebody in my chat proposed a idea for an anime.
I know Chad has said words do ra 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 ra.
I'm trying to process what exactly Baccano. The hell they're saying.
Baccano is pretty good.
The money of Baccano's soul and possibility control.
No.
I don't know what these words mean, man.
C is kind of interesting. I don't know if it's weird.
It's kind of tough.
Mushishi.
Mushishi? You want to do Mushishi?
I mean, it's just my favorite anime.
Oh, I don't know.
Be afraid.
Well,
I feel like I should be afraid right now.
No, actually, Mushishi is really, like, it's really tame. Such, yeah, it's like basically if you want to kick back and just chill out for like 30 minutes. I'm seeing like images
of a guy with white hair in a forest that looks like he
That's
hikes.
Mushishi.
Yep.
Yeah.
And it looks He's like a shaman. It looks like the exact art style from Gangsta, actually.
Yeah, it does yeah, look it super does. Similar.
Berserk? No.
That'd also be really long.
I do want to watch Berserk at some point because it's the inspiration for a lot of stuff in Dark Souls.
It's literally why Dark Souls exists.
Yeah, Dark Souls yes. and Dragon's Dogma okay. both take a lot of stuff from Berserk to the point where there was two Berserk
Dragon's
armor
Dogma
sets in Dragon's
was
Dogma.
Written. Dragon's Dogma was written by the Berserk author.
Oh,
yeah. So yeah,
oh, wow.
yeah,
yeah,
yeah. The Berserk the Berserk guy is really amazing, but also the shittiest person on the planet. okay, here's some backstory to Berserk. Is Berserk's on a kind of hiatus, kind of not hiatus, and it's been like that for
oh,
like
yeah, last episode we covered the horrible schedule of Berserk.
I think we were talking about Hunter x Hunter, but then compared it to Berserk as similar. But yeah.
Maybe, yeah. 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 We had a calendar involved.
That fucking guy, I hate him.
Yeah, that was
so
Hunter
much.
X Hunter, but yeah.
Every season, I see a new show by him, and I'm like, why are you making this moe garbage bullshit? Stop it. Make your Berserk. It's so much better. And he's like, it's hard. Hard to think of a plot. Like, yeah, I know. Stop, like, resorting to
They're
cute girls doing cute things.
They're stuck in a boat for, like, a year and a half or something like that.
I think that's the problem that the Walking Dead author runs into, is he's like, this yeah. thing's still ongoing after all these years, and he's like, I think that only one issue comes out per month. Of that comic because he's trying to figure out where the hell to make the whole thing go next.
I mean, looking at some stills from Berserk, and this is Dark Souls.
Oh yeah,
yeah.
My understanding is that Berserk is to Dark Souls what Warhammer is to Blizzard.
Blizzard,
yeah.
yeah. Blizzard Entertainment,
basically. Yeah, yeah. Like there are like direct. Enemy comparisons
yep.
between like
there
the demons from Berserk.
Sets.
Although I don't think that Dark Souls has a rape horse yet.
No.
Berserk
well,
still goes.
The answer is yes.
Well, yes, I suppose they have a lot of thunder attacks. I can tell you that much.
It was a more metaphysical rape.
Yes,
Jesus Christ.
We spent like 3 hours there specifically just to get burned through.
Oh yeah, it was really cathartic to watch.
That's good.
I warned you guys, and it was nice to see other people suffer.
It was actually surprisingly like
it.
Easy on my end. It only took a couple of tries, and then just
oh,
the
yeah.
bird side.
The problem that we
was
had
just,
was now imagine doing internet it issues on my end. Because when it came my turn to get through that area, that's when my internet started having the problems.
Right,
which
that was
it,
the issue.
Yeah.
Hey, Wander.
Yeah.
Are you watching Ajin?
No.
Okay. I was curious if you were going to pick that up or not.
So I actually haven't really gotten into this. Ooh. The answer is yes now, but,
Yeah, Ajin's really cool. Ajin's such a really cool concept, but it's... The only thing I don't like is the anime does that, like, weird 3D thing.
Oh. Well, they're doing that in Dimension M as well, or Dimension W.
Yeah, Dimension W has it sometimes, and the new Berserk series coming out is going to be, like, full-on 3D like that.
You know the one that's really weird that I didn't like? It was, like, Bada Baka or whatever... A BDBR or whatever. Oh shoot! Let me look this one up. It's one of the new seasons. I was trying to watch it and it was awful. But
it's from this season.
Yeah, it's from this season and it has.
Got the rape horse. No, please.
Oh god!
What's it called?
We're just sharing horrible Berserk images now. Apparently.
Berserk.
I was okay, but not seeing this.
I mean,
that's Berserk.
Like, Berserk starts heavy-handed as fuck. Like, you start Berserk and it slaps you in the face. It's like, you're in the wrong house, bitch. And I'm like, oh, I'm so sorry. Like, okay.
That's what Dark Souls does.
Yeah. It's like, please forgive me. I didn't know what I was stepping into. It's like, well, you're in now. It's like, okay.
It's like, that's what it's like seeing the Asylum demon. Like, you picked the wrong game.
It's like, well, can I leave? No, there's no leaving.
You know what I want to get into? And this is stepping a little bit away from.
I want to get into being
anime.
A millionaire.
Oh, but just to go back to my point, Bubuki Baranki. That one's all in 3D, and it just messes with my fate, my mind.
Bubuki Baranki. Is that what
it's
you
really
said?
Bad.
I'm sorry, I just saw the link that Andrew posted.
Where is this?
He posted a link that says women putting herb balls into vagina to detox their rooms have been warned of danger.
Oh, yeah, yeah, I saw that earlier today. I was just like,
that was on Reddit, and I was like, oh.
Where'd you find this? That, I was like, r/NotTheOnion?
Yeah.
It was like top of all, so.
Oh, I just heard Lady Bird Scott. Oh, man, yeah.
I don't want to read this
one. You know, another, like, I'll say another one I'm watching that's complete utter trash is Dagashi Kashi. It's like, it's just about some fucking kid.
Oh, that one. I read the manga for that.
That was the aura that Bird gives when you could literally be making stuff up and he wouldn't know the difference.
I'm just, actually, no, I'm just listening. That's just me saying, please continue.
So here's actually a I don't know if it's good or not, but Grimgar is a new one this season. All of the backgrounds are watercolor. Like the plot's kind of meh, but I would recommend at least taking a look at this one. Hi to Gensho no Grimgar, and just watch like 3 minutes in the middle and just look at the backgrounds. They're gorgeous.
Oh, I know what you're talking about.
I love how I can just type in complete shit into Google and it'll always translate it into the right anime I was looking for.
that's usually how anime works.
This is what I type.
The internet's filled with thousands of Americans who don't know how to spell animes.
If you're looking for an easier way to find it, just go there.
That's what I typed in.
All right, so we should reel this right in before it keeps going.
Well, Grimgall, it just got sucked in by Grimgall, and there you go. Yeah,
I guess I typed in Grimgall. It's Grimgar. It has an R at
actually,
the end.
Actually, it's well. They remember they
Interchange
L's and R's, so it's the same.
The light novel also translates over into writing.
Did someone just recommend The Melancholy of Haruki or Haruhi?
People are saying a lot of things.
Somebody did.
Suzumiya Haruhi.
The Melancholy of Haruhi. Don't start Haruhi. Don't do that to yourself.
So are we gonna watch Mushishi?
If you guys want to.
Is that what we're doing?
Try an episode of it. See if you like it.
I think it's chill enough that you might enjoy it because I can confirm that nothing is like really boring or bullshit about it, but it's like there's no like a obscene plot you have to like follow in characters.
Plot. All of the episodes are completely standalone, which I actually really enjoyed.
Cool.
Yeah, it's a basic brew yourself a cup of tea and just sit back and relax and have a good time. Like
nice.
All right, so our anime book club of the week is Mushishi this week.
Yeah,
man, I feel bad because like you guys are recommending anime. I've already watched all this shit.
Well, that's fine.
That's going to
chances
happen.
Chances are you've watched all of it. Period.
The whole point of this is basically like Bird and Keith learn anime. Is pretty much what this became.
Andrew, haven't you been watching the premiere of every season of anime for several years now?
Yeah, I've literally watched like the first season of everything that comes out. Like my anime list is awful. My anime list is just full of such garbage. But that's my life. What do you want, dog?
But so this is an anime. Wild new adventure where you're going to recommend us stuff so we don't have to look through it all.
Yeah, you're welcome. You're welcome. No, so this is girls' an anime, bravos for you.
But what I really want to get into is the Zatoichi films. You've heard of these, right?
No.
So, it's a series of films. They've been making them for like 30-40 years or whatever.
It and Google corrected me.
And it stars it's about a character who's a samurai who's also a massage therapist and he's blind.
No. Oh no.
And it's about him just like trying to do like martial arts shit, but like just keeps winding up in hijinks because he's still a really good martial artist, but he's still blind.
Yeah, I got three cutscenes in and I'm like, I mean images in and I'm like, is this a comedy, right? Probably.
Oh, it's definitely a comedy.
Kind of.
It's a comedy. Another really fun one to watch if you want to like a way back like really crappy Japan style television is a look up Kikaider. Kikaider's so garbage.
Kikaider.
Isn't that a Sentai?
Kikai.
I think there's an anime of Kikaider and then there's a live action of Kikaider.
Oh my god, what am I looking at?
Right? Oh, Kikaider's
what
amazing.
The hell is this? Kikaider this is looks, awesome.
Yeah.
Is this...
It's...
What?
It's in the time of, like, it's by the same guy who made, like, Ultraman. Whoa,
what's it called? Sentai?
Sentai, yeah. Yeah.
Sentai, yeah.
Yeah, it's basically by the godfather of all, like, Ultraman-esque kind of heroes.
Yeah.
He looks like a
this
French
flag. This is definitely
flag.
An Ultraman thing.
Yeah. Oh, it's so fantastic to watch. He, like, cruises around on a motorcycle and just, like, jumps off the motorcycle and it just vanishes. Just gone forever. And he just transforms in midair and kicks someone in the face and they're just like, get Gaidar!
Jesus Christ. Yeah, if you're only listening to this, imagine something that looks like a Power Ranger,
oh,
but it's also a robot. Like
it's like they took two Power Rangers and cut them in half and put them together.
I'm watching the first episode and it's awful. They made the floors out of styrofoam just so they could break through them.
He looks like he definitely looks like a clockwork Power Ranger.
Yeah, that's a great way of putting it. I'm watching on YouTube right now. There's episode one.
Oh God, Jesus. The actual like
this is
costume for season one. Oh God.
Yeah.
Oh sweet Jesus, this is terrible looking.
Oh yeah.
This guy's a Power Ranger built by Harley Davidson.
You know what? I've got display capture for this very reason.
Oh no.
You're welcome.
My face cam is now becoming Kikaider. All right.
Oh no.
My face cam is now just Kikaider for the rest of this episode.
His motorcycle has a sidecar that's four times bigger than the motorcycle. And it flies! What the fuck? What?
Yes, I love Kikaider. Kikaider's great.
The best part
how
is
does Japan
Keith,
have this
Keith
many
is
damn
forced to use
hits.
My face cam for this one. So good, we get Kikaider in this podcast.
Yeah, and then the video gets taken down forever. By obscure Japanese companies.
If this video is up on YouTube and hasn't gotten taken down, I think we're safe.
Alright guys, so this has been our third podcast.
Yeah, I guess that's Kikaider! A good Kikaider!
We still don't know what to call it or what its structure is.
Kikaider cast!
But this is happening. Oh.
I can't tell if the actor can see things. It looks like he's wondering.
It looks like he can't.
I don't think he can. I think he's completely unaware of what is going on around him. He's just punching and kicking.
I imagine you can see very, very vague shapes, and there are people just off camera that are just like gesturing which direction he needs to run and pose at next.
Yeah.
I think they take the face off for all action scenes and have him face away. Because I don't see the glowing eyes in the action scenes.
It for the most part, I think what they do is he just has like a headset and they just say like go left, go right.
That's what it looks like. The way he moves is it's very reactionary and sudden.
Yeah, like
I like
it's
the
someone...
camera here. It is totally just like a dude with a camcorder sprinting around in the field.
Yes,
it's so shaky.
Old school Japanese really shaky monster movies.
It's basically like during that era when everything was done, like filmed in some weird, like empty parking
gravel
lot
pit.
And
yeah.
Like the budget was like $30 and like
weird.
Everybody had to bring their own supplies. Like it was fantastic.
Cardboard ninja. Oh no.
These special effects are amazing.
I
Thanks
know that we need to
everybody.
Formally end the episode, but I can't stop watching Kikaider.
God damn it.
I'm so glad I recommended it.
God damn it, the podcast is over right now.
It's a visual tour de force, man. You don't even need to have the sound, you just watch and
the villain died and they dropped like electrical junk, including the covering for a light switch.
Yeah.
That had been spray painted.
I told you, it's just a bring your own shit to work day. I just filmed it.
And then fantastic. He drives away in his dinky little motorcycle.
His motorcycle is the shittiest vehicle I've ever seen.
It's fantastic.
For a superhero, quote unquote. This is great. I'm not watching Musishi, I'm watching this.